So when you're making this documentary, I can only assume that having the expertise that you have through being a therapist and listening to people's stories, in some kind of way, were you haunted, or what did it do to your psyche to know all these years that you had this experience? Is it part of your own therapy to create this documentary?
That's a really, really insightful question. Yeah. I don't know that I consciously belabored this story until recently. Well, until I actually started digging in and working on the documentary. I knew that I'd always felt passionate about, wow, how this story unfolded. Mm-hmm. And that there was something about it that I wanted to show to the world, mostly to women.
Yeah.
I wanted them to look at this. Look what happened here. Look how powerful we are together. Because for every sexual predator out there, there's more than one of us, right? Because they don't strike just once. So right there, we necessarily outnumber these guys.
Right, right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So to answer your question, I think what I do belabor is that I met him. I knew what I saw. Mm-hmm. And I was unable to stop him. That Christy had to die before we could stop him. And when I really started to look into his history, I realized so many other women not only just met him and were suspicious as I was, but were attacked by him at various degrees of his success or not success.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was haunted by the fact that all of these women, one at a time, sort of tried to, you know, yell out into the world, there's a cliff coming with this guy, and nothing stopped him. And and I'm kind of enraged by that.
Right.
So, yeah, I'm haunted to tell the story of, like, my God, what does it take? And and what were all of the things that happened along the way every time a single woman stepped up to try to stop him? Why wasn't he stopped that time? And why did it take 10 of us coming forward and Christy to die before they finally were like, oh, okay, we'll put him in jail and leave him there.
Yeah.
I mean, he'd been in jail before. He'd just kept getting let back out.
Is there a resolve? Is it, okay, so we've come together. The message seems to be that we need to come together. Our voices need to be heard. Maybe, perhaps, through this documentary, not only are you teaching other women to use their voices, but it may serve to a greater purpose in the end, that when it's time for his parole or whatever the case may be, there's still a wall here.
Right.
There's still strength here that's going to keep you locked up for the rest of your life.
Yeah, I don't think a lot. And another thing is about when women do have this happen, a lot of women do suffer sexual assault, go through the trial, and he does get convicted. And then 5-6 years later, when his parole hearing comes up, they don't realize that there's a protocol for them to go through so that they are notified when the parole hearing comes up so that they could be there and have their say, which is very powerful.
It is very powerful.
So very often these parole hearings come up, nobody shows up to be the voice of opposition, and they end up on the street. And I don't know if a lot of women know that there's follow-up to their voice as well, to keeping these guys behind bars.
Right. That, to me, should be the long life mission, to keep your freedom. We sometimes have to fight for it. In this documentary, I'm reading that so many people are participating, including her mother.
Yes.
How are you able to get her to agree to be a part of this?
Oh, it was so... It was such a, I just got chills, I don't know if you can even see it, but when I think of Terry, who's Christy's mom, she's an incredibly intelligent, grounded, expansively spiritual woman. When I speak with her, I walk away feeling cared for. And I try so hard to speak to her and show up strong, and but I end up feeling taken care of when I talk to Terry. I contacted her, I waited till the very last minute because I just... You know, it's a sensitive topic. And we cut the video that we put together, the 4-minute intro, and I knew it was time. If I was going to go public with that, I needed to bring Terry in on this. And so I got in touch with her, and I just wanted her blessing. I wanted her to know I was not planning on doing a salacious story about the daughter, the murder of her daughter. And that I wanted to honor her daughter's memory with this. And we spoke about it on the phone for a couple of hours, and she let me know. I've decided to... over time, share the story of Christy's life with you for this documentary, because I believe in the vision and I believe in your goals for it. And I was blown away. I was so moved by that.
Wow.
she'd not been willing to participate in
anything prior, because this story was nationwide. I mean, it was on so many news networks in the past.
Yeah, Dateline did it. And, you know, there's so many just investigation discovery channel. There's so many channels now that are just dedicated to making show after show after show.
I watch them. I do.
Yeah, I do. I do, too.
Yeah. I watch all of them. Yeah.
And, of course, they approached her, and she kind of held back. Because if you look at the story of Christy and how they tell it, they sort of portray her as this beautiful starlet who was chasing fame and got herself into trouble by going to an audition with the wrong guy. And it just burns me to hear that story.
Right.
You know, young actresses in LA go to auditions by themselves all the time. That's the definition of what we do. And so to kind of victimize her again by suggesting she just wasn't wise enough or wasn't careful enough, and her thirst for fame put her in this scenario, it just burns my ass. That's, I don't even know if I can say that, but it makes me mad. And so, rightfully so, her mom didn't want to subject her to any more of that kind of thing, but that's not what we're doing here at all.
It sounds like a beautiful tribute to her. It is still in the process of being created, made, edited. Where are you?
We're still shooting. We are still reaching out to the folks we want to talk to. A lot of folks are on board. And so right now we're in the process of, you know, getting the interviews shot. And we'll be traveling east to where the perpetrator actually came from and approaching his family, hoping they'll talk to us. We have law enforcement out there who's working with us. And we're just in the thick of it.
Wow. So is there anything that we can do to make this story tangible? Can we help? Can we donate? Can we, I don't know.
You can. I am absolutely grateful to have an independent funding source. It's one woman in Wyoming who'd like to stay a little bit anonymous.
Yes.
But she's so supportive of this project that she's giving us the bare bones of what we need to make sure we get it done.
Wow. Congratulations.
So that being said, we're getting it done.
Yes.
But can we use further support to get it out into the world and to really get it done right? Of course we could. And if you go to KathyIsIn.com, the video is right there on the front page. It shows you, if you want to click the PayPal and give $5, $100, whatever, you can. It's there.
KathyIsIn.com. That is her direct website.
Right.
I believe I saw a PayPal or a donation button or something there for you to support the story. It's something that needs to be in the universe, something that it sounds like it's going to even educate us on protocol in certain scenarios.
Yeah.
And that's so important to not only be authentic and transparent to share your story that way, but you're teaching.
I'm going to go explore all the variables of, like, what the hell happened here?
Wow.
And sort of take everyone on the journey with me.
That is incredibly brave. And I'm actually just humbled by the idea that you were this transparent about something that personal to you.
Oh, well, thank you.
I love how accomplished you are. You use so many different platforms. I think your core skill is communication, though. I think that's the nuts and bolts of it, and whatever platform you choose to use. I had mentioned before that she has a radio show, Satin Lounge. Yeah, I see. Yeah, they listen. They listen. It's on every Monday. That's right. Monday, 2 p.m. on LA Talk. No, LA. Yeah, LA Talk Radio.
It's 3 p.m. now. We moved. Oh, it was at 2. We moved.
You moved.
We were a 2-hour show. I took it down to 1 hour.
Okay.
In order to do the doc.
Okay.
You know, of every minute that you are producing on your show.
Sure.
It takes time to do it. I wanted to do it right. So
Very popular show, and you might need to teach me some of these skills. I mean, she has over 50,000 downloads of her radio show. It's called Kathy Is In, appropriately so. How would you describe your show? Is some of this couch therapy, a little giggle going on, you and your co-host Jenny McNulty? What's going on with your show?
Jenny McNulty, seasoned comedian in our community. Do you know Jenny?
I do know Jenny.
She's
hilarious.
And hilarity.
Yes.
She's my co-host. It's very eclectic, and it's very sort of off the cuff and relaxed. Mm-hmm. And as you say, it's really based on communication. We have guests of all kinds, and sometimes it's just Jenny and I.
Mm-hmm.
We take calls, we answer questions, we interview folks. Mm-hmm. It's really a mix. We have fun with it.
An eclectic mix of radio. You can have it any other way. I think I even read that you guys you're taking the radio show on the road now.